And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, ready to get in on some more action here with some sweet League of Legends going on between George Brown and Queens. We did see George Brown go one up in this series so far, but that's the great thing about a best of three is it is exactly that best of three. That means there are two more chances for Queens University to thunder back into this series and make a statement. We could see the young 2-0. We could see the young 2-1 coming out from any team. I want to see a game 3. We've not seen one yet, you and I. We've not had that expressed luxury of a game 3 cast yet. Does make our jobs possibly a little easier, but at the same time, less fun, right?
Yeah.
I want some more League action. That's why I'm here.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's right. I mean, I would go home and play video games by myself on a Friday night, but instead, I have to watch all these dank League of Legends games with you, Kyle. And
some sweet bro time.
That's right. I just want to spend some more sweet bro time casting some sweet League with, you know, some really awesome players, actually. Like, I haven't ever seen any poor sportsmanship coming out from any of the guys that we've even watched in this collegiate scene, so shout out to them for being top-notch players in terms of at least team play, you know, teamwork. You know,
sure.
If I was on their team, I'd give them that thumbs up.
Yeah.
That thumbs up in League, you know what
some
I'm saying?
Some of that not quite honorable opponent status, but all the same. We are just waiting for confirmation from these two teams to pop back into things. Gotta wonder what you're gonna change if you're the side of Queens, really, you know. I think a Bard ban or takeaway is something at least to be considered. You could say, well, it wasn't the reason we lost, but I'd say it was sure one of them.
Yeah, it was definitely, yes, the 0017 Raccoon Bard was definitely very abusive, right?
Yep.
It made that Ziggs way stronger. It made the entire team way stronger. His Bard ults were awesome. He almost always got a key player of Queen's University stuck in a Bard ult.
Yeah, you know? Oftentimes really capitalizing on the fact that Capone on that gen didn't have a lot of maneuverability.
Right.
Maybe you take a little bit of a change into the draft and go something that's not quite as landlocked, perhaps. To use an odd word to describe that situation. It'll be interesting because theoretically the rank differences in that bottom lane aren't too far off, right? It's all high gold and low platinum coming out around the side of both of these teams. So, some high platinum on the side of, actually, Capone. He is the highest ranked member of all the bot lanes there currently. So, expecting to possibly see a little bit more out of him. Definitely don't want, perchance, another Fiesta coming out of that bot lane. But, we'll see. I am also excited to see what Lord Luck can do. He's a shining point for his team last time around. Despite being on a losing game, had very current CS, was even in his kill-death ratio, so certainly something to consider there. Just a matter of watching them execute it, seeing if they can tighten down some of these screws that may have been a little loose the first time around.
Yeah, it makes me wonder if, like you said, if they are going to change those priority bans, and we will find out here in just a second.
Oh, yes, the picks and bans are live. Same teams, different sides. Queens on the blue, and George Brown representing the red.
Not a problem.
Misfortune Man coming out. Thank you very much, Queens University. And Kyle.
Doing the Lord's work.
We both salute you, sir.
Seems you left your brave pants at home. Want me to wait while you go get them?
Yeah, actually, that was good. Poppy. Yes, Kyle.
There's levels to it. That's all I'm saying. Ziggs banned out. Unsurprising.
Yeah.
I guess I wouldn't say Ziggs was the biggest problem last game, but certainly kept very current and didn't die once and was able to just shred towers. So certainly thinking far ahead with that ban, taking it out of that one. We'll see what else comes through. Rengar is still banned. Coming from the side of Bobby T. I'm sorry, no, the Pangu banned in that one. Bobby T is left with the last ban.
Yep.
Who was it last time that they subbed out for Ziggs? Malzahar. And so then the one that Ziggs has replaced was then Kha'Zix. So that will find its way through. Eli certainly could play that, especially if Lee Sin is taken away. Necropolistic says, hey, look, I can play this champion. Two can play it this game.
Yeah.
And so Well, actually, I guess technically 10 in all for one.
Don't bring up that game mode that gives me.
You don't like all for one,
dude. It's so hard. It's so hard. I'm like, oh, I have these skills. I can do this. And then I'm like, oh wait, my enemy also has these skills.
Or your team's just like, hey, let's pick Blitzcrank, most versatile all for one champion ever. I go AP, you go AD. Maybe someone thinks that attack speed is a thing there.
Dude, attack speed is totally viable.
It is not.
W.
Ladies and gentlemen, attack speed is not viable on Blitzcrank. I will find you. I will come to your house. Personally, shake your hand and tell you why you're wrong. That is my guarantee. Jin lined up for the side of Yami Yugi. Looks to be the pick. Bobby T, maybe just BMing a little bit with that one. Maybe to say, hey, look, here's two champions from your lineup last game. Take one of ours. We'll take two of yours.
Yeah, and I think this is part of some of the reason why I'm so excited about the 10 ban system.
Yes.
Because now you don't have a scenario where you ban out a jungler. Oh, Jace. And Rek'Sai being locked in for the side of George Brown University.
A hot swap in the jungle.
Ooh, spicy.
Some musical chairs.
So, that's why I'm excited for the 10-ban system, right? Is because, basically, it really came down to Queen's University. Like, hey, we have to ban out the Ziggs. We really want to ban out the Misfortune. Obviously, Rengar is really strong right now. That leaves Lee Sin on the table, and he caused you a lot of headaches.
Right.
You really don't have a lot of choice. You either give it over to him, or you pick it yourself and hope you can at least survive on it, right?
Right, sure. Well, it is some early game presence that was severely lacking from the side of Queens. They had some signs alive to them, but
yeah. The
early game sort of just got too far away from them, and they weren't able to do much with it from then on. So I like seeing them pick a more early game focused jungler. I like seeing them pick support with a little bit, I don't want to say more utility than Janna, because I don't think you get more utility than Janna.
No.
But what is the quantity that Thresh has that he brings to the table?
I think it's a different kind of utility than Janna.
So perhaps a little bit more engage potential from Thresh coming out than Janna. Does still have very good disengage options with his flay, with his box, even using the hook to pull somebody to the left or right of some of the action. So I like to see that coming through. Some Lucian as well.
The old wife steal bot lane.
All right, this is just letting me know that Chazzy's ghosting the stream right now because he heard about
Blitzcrank.
He's going to build attack speed Blitzcrank.
I really want him to.
Don't do it,
Chazzy.
Please.
Chazzy, please take Blitzcrank in the mid lane. Do not worry about AP damage at all. Gangplank can definitely do all of the AP damage that you need.
It's like a bad episode of Chazzy. Oh, this is a nightmare.
Warwick
would be excellent. Please lock that in.
Please give me a Warwick, baby. I want
to
see. I really want to see the Warwick rework in action in a game that I am not playing in.
Right? Yeah, it's like a lot of fun if you're not the one directly responsible for it.
Yeah, if you're not the one like being chased by the crazy feral hound through the jungle.
Right.
Oh, please do it.
No. Nami locked in. Bot lane counterpart to Varus. I really like some of the switch arounds that are coming out, so I wanted to touch on the Lucian for Capone earlier. What was it that I said right after the game? Hey, maybe a little bit more mobile of an ADC. Boom! Dash Lord Lucian coming through.
That's right.
Don't know how good he is in current meta.
So he got a little bit of a buff in 7-1.
Okay.
They buffed the damage on his Lightbringer passive.
Okay.
So he does do increased damage off of that, if I remember correctly. I think they buffed it by 5 or 10 AD per six levels or four levels, I believe.
Okay.
Because his is one of those that scales like 5 times instead of at like every 6 levels.
So the relevant portion of that is just that he's going to stay a little bit more current in damage scaling throughout the game.
Right, because one of the biggest problems with Lucian is he brought a lot to the table without a lot to sacrifice for it.
Sure,
and
okay.
So that's why they did a lot to nerf him. He was very mobile. He was with both of his Q, his W, and his E, he was able to lay down a lot of poke and a lot of damage heavy poke because of his passive Hecarim and Orianna getting locked in.
Does suggest perhaps a Lee Sin top. I think he's a little bit more tuned for the top lane than Hecarim, but I don't know that for sure.
Yeah, that's the thing. Yes.
Current meta. So Hecarim against either one of these things against a Jace feels like it would be Headache City.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Oh, he's giving us the old random.
Yeah, I'm just going to keep clicking through things. I'm just going to say my thing. Come up. Cassio, Graves. That was Evelyn. Gragas is there too sometimes. Draven, hello. Oh my goodness, Gnar was Echo. Yeah, this is awesome.
Have you actually noticed the theme here? I don't think he's like randoming everyone.
No,
he's
going back between
subset.
G's and E's.
Oh. Wow, this is really spicy.
We slipped into a D there with Draven once.
Draven.
See, now he's caught on to us.
Now there's Caitlin.
Now you're spicing it up. Cassio is going to be the lock-in. So, we'll take that one out in the mid lane as a response to the Orianna. Nothing too crazy there. It does depend on the skill of the player, not the champion in that matchup. So far as we've seen, Cassio a little bit more aggressive, Orianna a little bit more of a team player
right.
in that regard. So, Lord Luck taking that one away from Chazzy. We did see Chazzy play that Orianna last game, so it is a double takeaway by Necropolistic and Lord Luck. Eli has responded, picking away that Rek'Sai, and Chazzy is bringing something new to the table with the glorified Snake Lady.
Snake Lady is scary.
Yeah, really.
She really is scary. Like, all the games that we've seen Cassiopeia play in, she has not only, like, done well, but she has gotten going early, and it has caused massive headaches for the enemy team.
No kidding.
And so Cassiopeia, she's definitely not, like, one of the sleeper mages, but in the world of Orianna's that we've seen, she's there, and she's very obnoxious.
No, you're not wrong there.
Although, I think it is important to note that Lord Luck has an excellent team for Orianna. Necropolistic on Lee Sin, and the Pengu on Hecarim. Mm-hmm. Excellent ball delivery services. Actually, even Thresh as well if he lands a hook and he follows it up.
Thresh Express, or maybe even, you know, Lantern in some sort of fun Hecarim character to charge right on through there. So, excited to see how that one will pan out. Single teleports coming out from the side of George Mason this time. Queens ran the double teleport last time, and they have decided to opt for a different strategy there. So I do like that. You never like to see someone doubling down on a strategy that just clear-cut didn't work for them. But they've adapted, so has the side of George Brown. They said, look, we're not going to play the same thing. You may think you've got that strategy beat. Maybe you do. We're not using it. Duh.
A surprise.
Bamboozled on, nerds.
This isn't, season 4 Cloud 9, where it's just Zyra Ash?
Season 3. Yeah, that was right when they made their debut onto the scene, the summer split of Season 3.
We're just going to keep doing the same thing over and over again.
So it would be Balls would play Rumble in the top lane, Meteos on Zac, High would play Zed, and we'd have Ash Zyra, and it's just like the Cloud 9 composition of, hey, we're just going to beat you with this.
You know it's coming.
Idiots aren't going to ban it either. They're just going to be like, hey, we pick Ash Zyra every game. Maybe you should just leave Ash Zyra up every single game. It's not that good, right? Ash isn't that good.
Kyle, you really...
I'm a little caught up in this meme.
I was going to say.
We should have tapered off on this one. That's okay. That's all right.
So
I like a lot of league history of the LCS.
Yeah, well, because there's so much. It's very rich. And if you're tuning in from Josh Lee and the SiriusXM Esports show, you kind of heard me and Kyle on there a little bit talking about the David Hill situation.
Yeah, okay.
And how there is some esports history there. And if you didn't hear about that, I highly recommend that you go at least read up on David Hill and the ESL contract. Get the word out. You know, be open-minded for sure, but you know, be wary of the situation. Be aware.
Sure. You got to know, because knowing is half the battle.
That's right. To be in the know, you need to know.
Right. Stay up to scruff on this. It is important to foster growth in the scene that we all know and love. We assume you know and love it because, let's be honest, you wouldn't be watching a collegiate-level esports tournament going on if you weren't a big fan of some sweet League of Legends action. So, we certainly are.
And, yeah, so we are about 30 seconds away from getting into the game. I want to do one last quick roundup of how these team compositions, it may be what they're trying to do with each. I would definitely look at Lee Sin to be very, very gank heavy, maybe relying on trying to go up there and get that Jace. Jace does not have any really good escapes there in the top lane. He can use, what's his E called? It's the line.
Acceleration gate.
The acceleration gate to the vroom vroom gate to kind of help him escape. But I definitely would not say that it is it's a masterful escape option.
Sure.
You really just kind of have to have that and run away. So maybe have Lee Sin focus a little bit more on Bobby T, which I will admit Bobby T was not that strong in the early game last time.
Okay, no, you're right.
He did die twice before anything really kind of started to happen in the game. So maybe applying some early pressure there, getting your Hecarim taking up, to get tanking up, to get your Lee Sin, kind of just get him a good feel for the game, right?
I actually wanted to touch on that before we got carried away into the commercial break last time around. Bobby T certainly had the worst score on paper of all of his teammates, but he kept drawing members of the side of Queens up to his lane to deal with it. He had the worst score because they had to focus so many resources onto him. Well, we are into game, and as you can clearly see from this HD stream, there are no technical difficulties on our side, perhaps, though, on the side of the players this time, so it's not just us.
That's right. We had one mess up, ladies and gentlemen. Gosh.
We bamboozled ourselves, but we've forgiven ourselves. So now the next important part is you forgiving us as well.
That's right. And with
or
any
something like that. I'm not quite a therapist.
Forgiveness is a two-way street, Kyle. So
viewers, will you marry me?
No, Kyle. You can't say that on the first date.
Oh. Maybe we've got some repeat viewers out there. Only that anyone would put themselves through this two or three times.
Typical schmoesby.
That's what they're... Oh, no. I always thought of myself more than Marshall.
Please, if we're getting caught up in the memes again.
Oh, boy. Well, there's not much else to do. 7 seconds into this game, these players have done an outstanding job for themselves, really solidifying their footholds on this one. We see the mastery spasm coming out, and yeah.
Yeah, the mastery flash, letting us know that somebody is a true player. Ooh, Varys. Oh,
sick.
Oh, look at it. That was really spicy.
Tossing out the what up, throwing down from the side of George Brown Queens. In return, does toss up some swag there. And it looks like both teams moving as a five-man unit might be on a little bit of a collision course here for this.
Yeah, this is actually really great. They do have some really fun level ones. If Rek'Sai takes Burrow, Nami also has her bubble.
Thresh Hook.
Thresh Hook, baby.
Hook City.
And you also have Lee Sin follow-up. So not a lot in terms of like sustained team fight, but you definitely are going to see a lot of a really quick one and gun would be my guess.
Right, sure, down to the wire. Hopefully we do get a little bit of that action because it does help bring some excitement to these games.
Yeah.
As a play-by-play caster, I live for that excitement.
You live and die by team fights.
I do.
I live and die by wards. So, you know, so...
Were you one of the ward clappers?
Yeah, I was.
When you've gone to write over? Oh.
I went to MSI 2015 when it was in Tallahassee, Florida.
Yep.
I went, every time there was a ward killed, I was like that one dude in the first four rows. It was like, yeah!
You were wrapping the whackers together. Boom, 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 boom.
The thunder sticks, baby.
Oh, boy.
Woo!
The days.
What a time to be alive.
Yeah.
Oh, Capone, repping the heart. Seeker Lucian skin.
Just in time for Valentine's Day. Gotta love it. He's looking to find that special someone in the bot lane and then absolutely obliterate them.
Actually, it's really funny that Lucian is finding a special someone in the bot lane when Thresh is the one who took away Lucian's special someone.
Yeah, that's pretty upsetting, actually.
There's some League of Legends lore that hasn't been replaced, ladies and gentlemen.
Nope. Still tried and true. We have another thief in the bot lane in the form of raccoon, looking to possibly steal Lucian's heart there.
Yeah, that's right. Nami, the koi. Oh no, penguin.
Yeah, I don't think Pangu really thought this.
Did you
one
want
through.
That?
That's first blood. Ghosted
oh, no.
out, but did not matter much. Bobby T saying, "Well, okay, if you insist."
Hello, my name is Jace, and I do a lot of damage at level one.
Oh, boy.
Thank you for playing.
Yep. So already off to that first blood. Yada Yugi has such a commanding presence over this lane with the help of raccoon there. I think maybe it's just a little bit of residual nerves coming out.
Oh, no.
Man, this is crazy. Wow. Okay, so two
oh,
solos.
Oh, no!
Oh, goodness. Oh, not the landing phase you're expecting if you are the side of Queens. Maybe just some nerves coming out, being a little bit rattled from the last game. Maybe. I hesitate to say the dreaded T word.
The tilt? Oh, sorry.
I was hesitant to say it. Oh, but there's Capone going in on the raccoon. Does force the flash out. Yami Yugi. Thanks to a nice exhaust from Zazix, cannot get in to find the final shot onto Capone. So, all in all, decent enough defensive play coming out on the side of Queens to stay alive there and actually push back the side of Raccoon. Did force the flash exhaust.
Are you ready for the snipe?
Oh, nice snipe hook toss in, and it's going to be a tower shot to boot. Summoner heal forced out, taken away. Yami Yugi punished very, very heavily for what was... pretty big misposition into a really good capitalization from Zazix.
Yeah.
I'm already liking this Zazix support a lot better than last game.
Yes, he's playing extremely well, and it's just, it's very satisfying to see a good Thresh player.
Oh, no,
and as a support, I mean, yourself, I'm sure you know the feeling that I am referring to.
Kangaroo's getting baited, and that's the knockup. That should be death, almost certainly. The red buff should do it if the attacks don't. Eli finds it, but now Necropolistic is there, looking to go in. Do you want it? I think the answer is currently no, not without that Dragon's Rage to knock back into the tower zone. So another takeaway on to the side of Kangaroo coming out from Bobby T. This time credit over to Eli. Necropolistic thinks Eli's gone. That's bad. He's going to go in, does find the vision actually, but I don't think he wants this. Is going to get bullied out. They're going to try to follow up, but they can't do it with Pengu right here. Looks like he will find the one kill onto Bobby T, but no, a nice knockup means no, Bobby T! Are you kidding me? If he survives this, does not. Eli takes it away in the 1-4-1. Necropolistic goes down. Bobby T goes down. Jungle for top. Pengu finds himself on the receiving end of a nose bloodying and doesn't even get the kill for it.
Yeah, I mean, that was holy
moly. Oh, missing the point blank. Zazix can't hit them all, right? Raccoon's gonna go pretty low from this one, but won't die. So, all in all, a lot of scrappy fights coming out. The back and forths are getting pretty close here, and then we're seeing just kind of that one little to push it over the edge from either team. So,
yeah.
Junglers can't be everywhere, though. They do look like they're running toward the bot lane. We have the Cassio Realm coming in from the backside as well. On a collision course, possibly with Lee Sin, so I would.
Maybe in the jungle, even.
Nah, I think she's. She changed her mind, probably for the better there.
Yeah, that would have been a really bad gank. Thresh coming up there, warding that Tri-Bush, getting the control ward out really early. He wants to protect that, wants to protect their backside, which is actually really, really big. When you have a jungler like Rek'Sai, protecting your backside is huge. Because she can just burrow right in and cause you a lot of headaches, especially if you're going to be pretty pushed up like this as well.
That's why after level 6, you have to be so careful with that tunnel management. You know, most people see Rek'Sai tunnels and go, well, if they're not doing damage to me, they're not a problem. No! Stand on them! Get the gold! Get rid of them!
Get that 5 gold, baby! Mm. Here comes Necropolistic sitting in the bot lane, though, maybe trying to make something happen.
Yeah,
for
they don't
know
he's here. That's going to be Eli coming in on the side, but Yami Yugi's in trouble. Going to get knocked back there from the fresh play. It's going to be a low champion, but the flash does come out, and this is actually bad news for the side of Queens. I don't think they really anticipated that nice flash coming out from Yami to stay alive there, so really well done to turn that one around. Not obviously what they thought was going to happen with Eli coming in. They thought they were going to have a nice gank. It was Necropolistic a little bit ahead of the curve on that one, but couldn't capitalize. Again, scrappy fight, no resolution.
Yeah, I mean, super awesome play actually by Eli. So what he did is he chained the finish of the capture bubble by Nami and chained that into his unburrow. So they got two knockups in a row to actually keep Yami Yugi safe from that. Eli.
Oh no, Necropolistic, what are you doing?
Do you want
to
be there?
I don't think that was the call you wanted to make. The shockwave does come out, but Lord Luck has none in terms of finding the kill. Playback, but not enough. Lord Luck on the retreat. Zazix, well below half health, does have to flash, finds the hook, but it's only going to delay the inevitable, perhaps, as the ult does come out. Chazzy finds a kill there onto Zazix, and that one is out of here. Capone trying to find Eli, but is quite alone in this situation, and many members are still there. Only level 4 has to use the plant to pop over the wall. Couldn't follow up. And so that should be red buff getting taken out and away pretty convincingly for the side of George Brown.
Yeah, so that actually... So Chazzy did a really good job chasing Thresh, and there's a lot of really good follow-up by Raccoon coming up from the bot into that jungle side. And Eli did a really good job in there as well, but I think it's important to note that Chazzy didn't need to use his ult there.
Yeah, it did seem a little redundant. Was the champion was facing away from you, right? And so
he did it for the slow, which I understand, but he actually had Empower auto attacks by Nami, so he could have used it and still proc to slow anyway.
Okay, cool. I didn't see that's thinking 3 steps ahead.
Yeah, so that's one of those things where I was like, oh, okay, he just auto attacked, but maybe he wasn't in range. It looked like he was, but it's all right if he wasn't. He's probably not going to be using his ult for like the next. You know,
right, it's already halfway through the cooldown. The wave pressure's pushing in the mid on the back. So
right.
All in all, no harm, no foul. Map kind of quieting down. We've seen some blood across these first 8 minutes of the game. 7 kills to boot, but
yeah,
no towers yet, no dragon plates. So while certainly the side of George Brown's looking for that blood, they're finding it, but not much else.
Yeah, the kills are being highly contested in the sense that while...
miss both things from the side of George. They're going to try to get in onto Capone, but I don't think they can follow up as well. Nami's going to try, but they are just going to be able to boost right on through. That snipe from Yami Yugi will not connect. Capone not in range to really dash culling or combo anywhere through there. Not even actually in level range to culling yet either, so
Yeah, he is a little bit farther behind just because of how much attention has been on the bot lane. He hasn't been around for it. He wasn't around for the kill that Lee Sin had.
Right, that is
which
true.
Was in the top lane, so... but obviously neither was Paris, actually, now that I look at the score. Only Nami was.
Oh, so close. That's why you always go for the dragon this thrash. Go get to the dragon so you can pull yourself over.
Ooh,
oh, Chazzy, not bad. Chazzy flashing out. Good reactive flash to get out of that one. We'll see if he can get out of this one fully out and away. They are going to be able to chase him right through that speed buff up part, so he's going to be more and more trying to get the speed buff up there. Flash is a little bit unnecessary, but does find it with the shockwave to take it away, so... Trades a kill in the mid lane for the dragon, but Capone could be in some serious trouble here thanks to the chain of corruption. Will spread to Thresh. Knockup will connect as well. Half health teleports coming out, but I don't think it's going to do too much for him. Even if he does go aggressive here, which he will, we're going to be seeing if he can get a kill or not. Pangu is charging through, but his health bar is so low already. They find Eli, but they can't follow up. He flashes in. He says, I want to be found, and does get that careful what you wish for because the fight is now turning around. Pangu on the double kill takes out Yami Yugi as well, finding Raccoon. Does not have the health bar for the tower dive, but does have the next best thing, and that's a big minion wave. Not going to follow through with it regardless.
Yeah, they don't have a whole lot of health, and they have to be careful. Jace has his TP up, but there are no wards, so the best he can do is TP to tower and defend it.
Really refreshing to see them try to play that out, though.
Yeah, that, I mean, that was excellent by Queen's University. They did a really good job. Hecarim with an excellent teleport. The Pangu doing very good job going in aggressive. Zazrix landing the teleports that he needs. Bobby T is going to trade towers in the top lane, get 650 gold, and maybe go aggro here on Necropolistic.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage coming out from both pretty quickly onto one another. But nice flash out from Bobby T. Says, drink that one, Necropolistic.
Yeah.
Ouch. That's tower and a kill, so...
It's 950 gold right there, baby.
Yeah, because the first tower advantage, not what you want. That's going to be payday for Lee Sin there. Or, I'm sorry, for Jace there. 3.1k gold in his pocket before the back, still 1,000 to his name, so really chewing through that to find that Black Cleaver, some long swords, some health potions, whatever else is just, you know, cleaning house on that one, so.
What can I do to make myself even more impressive?
Hmm.
Why, yes, a Black Cleaver. Thank you, gift shop man.
Yeah, you gotta wonder if they've got beef, right? The two shop owners on either side of the rift?
Because they do an A-Rams, right? The two guys in the A-Ram.
Do they?
Yeah.
So I gotta confess something. I play with sound off when I play A-Ram.
Yeah.
It's just so obnoxious to hear this. It's so consolidated and dense is the only word I can toss out there. So all of Riot's hard work in terms of putting in...
The sound designers.
Fun voice acting. Yeah, like all those guys are effectively like dead to me. Uh-oh, and speaking of dead to anyone, Kha'Zix does miss it, so all the CC from supports is coming through, but Nami does finally find the first one with the tidal wave. Will keep off the side of Queens from doing too much. Necropolistic wanted to get in, couldn't find it, so nice defensive play from Raccoon there to kind of keep things mitigated. Not having the same statistical game that he was last time around, but still impressive in that he hasn't died, has had pretty good heal for his carry. He's only given up one death on Varus, and there's only so much you can do when Varus is your AD carry and caught out in one of those perfect storm ganks.
Right, and it's one of those things is that Raccoon does have a lot of healing down. If you watch him during the fights, he's doing really well at getting those triple bounce Nami heals.
Really helping over the wall, finds Chazzy.
Oh no.
Ball delivery did not go through the way they planned it.
Yeah, Chazzy was in a pretty easy spot to land that command shockwave, but Lord Luck just pulled the trigger at the wrong time. Pangu not where he needed to be to make that land.
No, I don't think he needed to come over the wall like that, really. He could have just come around it. Bobby T, though, is in the bottom side of the map here. That's four collapsing. Finds one already. Zazix, just the formality, will be the next one. They give it over to Bobby T. But now here's Lee Sin on the back line. Careful going in on that one. Yeah, no, there's a lot of burst. Bobby T has that Black Cleaver for damage. Is he going to try to set up a snipe? Eli tanking up some good damage. Bobby T finds it. Will be at the cost of Eli, but that should just be... No, it's not an execute. Necropolistic did still have the timer on that one, so...
Yeah.
1-1, but does easily secure them. A tower here gives another kill over to Jace, who they're trying to get snowballing, and all in all should pave the way for some wide openings here on the bottom.
Yeah. So I'm actually starting to see Bobby T's playstyle here. he is definitely not what I would call your traditional tank team player. He is not. He's not a Poppy. He's not a Nautilus. He's not a Maokai. He's not a.
Mm-hmm.
He's not a poverty top laner. He wants to carry you. He's a Zion Spartan.
Right.
and so it's sorry, Kyle.
No, I'm just we'll bounce back from it. You know, CLG is always bad at the beginning of the season.
True.
Regardless.
So back to the game at hand. He is a carry type top laner to the point where he'll carry based on kills and he'll split push. And then he'll show up, make something happen because he's so far ahead, and then he'll go back to doing his business and then no one can kill him.
It's making such a nuisance of yourself that the team has to... other team, nice flash from Zazix, but all in all, could have been avoided if he were not so far extended by himself into what is currently enemy territory. If you don't have those outer powers and if you don't have the wards in your jungle, that river is a dangerous place to be. The side of George Brown is looking to get up into this mid tower. They want it, but they're not going to get it. 15 minutes, a little bit slower of a game so far than what we saw last time around. More measured play coming out from both teams, right?
Yeah. Look at Jason in the top lane like we were talking about. That tower is pretty much dead. Actually dead.
No, yeah, actually dead.
And now Pengu actually might be dead.
I think he wants to follow up because Lee Sin is on the back line. That's going to be the ult in, but look at the damage. Bobby T still finds it and may get out of this one with his life. Are you kidding me? No! Does finally go down just to the edge of Necropolis in there. In the meanwhile, the mid lane is a dangerous place to be for the side of George Brown.
Oh,
Eli's
no.
Going to get in. Jazzy finds it. They're getting in on the Capone. He's going to die. He is Azure, the only one left. And they're chasing him down, but they're not going to get it, I don't think. Necropolis is here. Does not connect the Sonic Wave. Oh, man. So close and so far away for the side of Queens.
Bobby T just not having enough damage to survive that two-man gank in the top lane. But then also, I need to level a little bit of criticism here and just hang on.
Oh, boys, Azix is going to die here under his own tower. Takes what he thinks is the end, but is
actually
out. There is Pangu using a nice teleport ghost to get in and about. Does not have the home guards yet, so has to use the summoner spell in lieu. But the Trinity Force easily guarantees it.
Yeah, and so back to what I was saying, is there, I have to level some criticism against Queen's University just because they didn't need to follow, right? Lord Luck didn't need to, well, push his luck.
But, nice.
Yeah, he didn't.
Bobby T, though, he was going to find a crop of list of trades his life for a dragon. I'd say worth, but it was only a cloud drake, so.
Not really.
Yeah.
Especially because they got Infernal first. So, yeah, Lord Luck didn't need to chase. That put them in a bad spot. Kept them really low health. I mean, I guess that was a good kill by the Pengu taking out Rek'Sai, and it gave them the chance to secure the Drake.
Nice hookup, Bobby T. That aggressive playstyle is going to net him half his health in tower damage, but he turns around so much to Lord Luck that I don't think he really cares, especially with Nami there as a healing agent to begin with. Lord Luck having a base there, so this should be possibly another tower down. Hecker wants to go in on this, but Miasma will do a lot in terms of keeping him out. Chazzy finds the killing spree, doubling down, killing the bot lane in one fell swoop, and will be pushing through the rest of this mid-tier tower. And just like that, we thought the side of Queens was digging in reasonably well, but it was really just the side of George Brown saying, yeah, just wait, we're only starting here. That's going to be another in onto Bobby T. Looks like he's probably going to die here, but not before he turns him around. Yeah, doesn't die, actually. Goes in, kills it. That's the outcome he was expecting, that scrap along in the top lane. Was able to find it thanks to the supportive efforts of his team, and Necropolistic, not sure if that was... They're going to keep playing like nothing's happened there. I hope everything's okay. Maybe a pause coming through pretty soon, but we will just ignore that for the time being and watch as more action goes down. Yami Yugi getting pretty relevant as Varus. 1-2-4 is not the score we really talk about, especially with three start out. There's the reconnect. Okay, we're in good shape there. So does have that tier, the Warhammer, and the Dirk there all to say, well, you know, we might finish something down the line. We're not sure. He's changing his major, is the collegiate equivalent of this one.
Oh God, don't remind me.
So close!
I'm having flashbacks to my major.
You're so close.
Not like this.
Mr. Staircase.
God.
You need only believe if you wish to achieve.
You can't say stuff like that while I'm trying to get some water, dude. I will spit it all over your keyboard. So
you need only hydrate if you wish to be great.
No, stop! Okay, I'm going to talk about the game so I don't make...
So I'll talk about the game while you're long-winded there.
Thank you.
Necropolistic is going to be in trouble just due to two members, Raccoon, and the damage coming out from Chazzy really most of the oppressive factor in there. Eli does join as some front line, so we're going to see what they can do. Keep in mind, there is no Varus here, but there's a very fed Jace to compensate. Looking for that flank or possibly just the push in onto that bottom side. So I think they're in pretty good shape to take this tower. It is going to be defensive efforts clearly failing from the side of Queen. That's, they didn't really make much effort for that tower and punished pretty quickly for it.
Yeah. I mean, what are you really going to do, though, if you're the side of Queen University? It's, you're down by basically like 11.2k, right?
Right.
You don't have any outside turrets. You only have 8 kills, and 6 of those are on your jungler and your top lane.
Right.
That's not exactly where you want your centralized
lane. Not the distribution you're looking for.
Yeah, and even so, while Lucian did get buffed and he is somewhat relevant, I still wouldn't say that he would be a priority pick right now.
Sure, yeah. Hasn't been as, I don't want to say bad, but hasn't had the same necessarily lapses that we saw coming out of the first run around. Necropolistic wants in. That's a nice shockwave to get onto Eli and Raccoon. The ult will come out from Nami, and Eli finds a kill on the Necropolistic, but it is a kill turnaround coming in from the side. Bobby T under the tower is going to go down 2-for-2 thus far, but the low health bars are signaling danger for the side of George Brown. They have to back off, and good play, good defensive play to dig in and say, hey, look, we're going to fight under tower. You're not going to take it. If they started doing this a little bit earlier, maybe they wouldn't be 6 towers down now.
Yeah, I think in this case, it's like, this is the point where they can really just dig in, because before, they didn't have a good defensible position, right? You had your first and second tier turrets. That's not a really great place to try to buckle down.
Sure, especially with the flanking potential coming out from Bobby G so often.
Yeah, exactly. So, but at least when you're in your base and you have all of your turrets up, your inner turrets up, you at least can feel safe in knowing that no one's going to be hopping over those lines to come and get you.
There's some cloud drag there for a little bit of speed and maneuvering throughout as well. So, all in all, we're going to see how far in they can get, especially if the Baron does come out for the side of George Brown here. They certainly look like they want it.
Oh,
Necropolistic is in trouble. If the jungler dies here, that is all but Baron guaranteed for the side of GD. So they're going to get him to half health. They're going to get him to a quarter health. They're going to get him to no health. Lord Luck cannot save him, but Capone still wants to chase this one, oddly enough. I think he's going to come around to his senses. Here's Bobby T on the back line. Going to find Zazix. And he's trying to keep this champion locked up. And look at that. Gets locked up himself. Health bar taken out. Does trade away. Bobby T goes down. Shut down. Favor Hecarim, and who's going to get back into the fight here. Pengu is trying his damnedest, but is going to get chopped up and spat out. Ace coming through for the side of George Brown. They're not even going to worry about the Baron. They're going to start focusing on some inhibitors.
Yeah, I mean, you have the majority of your damage dealers up still. You don't have Jace, who is really good at killing turrets because of his triple shot on his W when he's in long range form, but you still have Varus, who is doing respectable damage, having the Monomune up and also the Yomu's Ghost Blades to kind of help with that. And you also have Cass, who is 7-1 and 7 with the Morel, Namakon, and the Rylite, being very, very oppressive right now. And obviously, Rek'Sai building that Tiamat is nothing to laugh at. That is a bit of damage that will burn out.
We talked about it last game. It was Tank Rek'Sai versus Tiamat Rek'Sai, and it seems to be the side of George Brown really not caring about tanks, right?
Yeah.
They're not going to worry about it. They're going to play without tanks, and they're going to run damage-heavy jungle top, and it's just going to work for them.
Yeah. And I think it'll work until somebody decides to really start taking team fights to them.
Yeah, it'll work until it doesn't.
Right, exactly. We were winning until we weren't.
Oh, boy.
I love me some Boy Boy. Where's that Boy Boy?
That was Skara describing Team Coast.
That's right.
So, some more Zion Spartan memeage coming out there.
Oh, Zion.
Back in the days where he teamed up with Shifter.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they used to be GGU, who was in the first split of the LCS, actually the second best team, only losing out by one game to TSM to take the entire finals. So, yep, Coast, otherwise known as GGU, used to be the second best team in the world. They rebranded as Coast because they were talking about back when TSM Baylife was a really big thing.
Bruh,
they were saying like, well, now it's Coast, so Coast Life. And I was like, a little bit of cringe history there.
Yeah, and also, fun fact, not a whole lot of wards around on the side of Queen University trying to protect this Baron Pit, but how could they? They've been in their face for the last 5
years. Probabilistic wants it. The health bar's there, but he cannot find it quickly enough. Does not get in. Capone dodging out from all the damage there. Good play by Thresh to get him out of that one. Zazix doing the job of the support, but One good lantern does not. Oh no. This is not where you want to be, Mr. Capitalistic. Behind enemy lines and flashing red, I think Bobby T is just going to keep him a little busy there. Waiting for the right time to find the back. He's going to circle around the full. Meanwhile, the mid lane is getting pretty pushed up by Baron and Power's minions aside. Of George Brown looking to maybe go reset some of that top pressure. They know they don't need to worry about the mid too much. It will auto push. Start the split push going on. Bobby T in that bot lane. The rest of the team in the top side.
Acropolistic making the escape.
Yep, he finally got out. Don't know whether he earned it or they gave it to him, but regardless, he's out in the way. Lee Sin's a slippery son of a gun to try to catch in the jungle, so.
Be free, my blind monk. Be free.
Certainly. His efforts are rewarded in the fact of. Not being 3-9-3.
That's right, of not being dead.
dead.
So, this is a difficult one for me to really say that, like, George Brown University has definitely won this game.
It's hard to start thinking otherwise, just because of the dire situation you find yourself in. Maybe if Jace weren't so freaking strong, if it were just a more traditional or almost like boring tank level split pusher. Oh, but that's going to be it. They're going in for it. Pengu wants to fight it. Yami Yugi will be taken up pretty low. That's going to be a nice shockwave. Chazzy's dominating the finds. That one out in the Crocodilistic is trying to get in through things. Does have to take the lantern back out. Eli keeping up some good damage for his team. That's going to be a snipe coming through from Yami Yugi on the side of the Crocodilistic. Does find that one out. Zazix cannot survive. Does flash. Does not matter. Capone, the last member standing, running back for the base. Bobby T, in the meantime, finding the base, destroying everything solo while his team kept the efforts busy. Jeez. In the top lane. Capone back in with the BM. Yami Yugi gets the stat pad before the game is out and over to end 6-2-7. 25:32 on the clock. 1 minute longer than the last game.
Yeah. Yeah, 1 minute longer, but the score is, the difference between the two teams is eerily similar.
Yeah.
With George Brown University really kind of taking it away.
10 towers, 2-0. Pretty nasty game coming out from them there to lay on all the pressure pretty quick. Only an hour and 23 minutes since we turned on the stream, and it is already over. George Brown came to play. They weren't messing around.
Yeah, they did extremely well. I mean, just lot of pressure.
Mm-hmm.
They exerted a lot of pressure. The ADC Ziggs pick,
right?
Really, like Ziggs in the ADC position, not necessarily ADC Ziggs, but
short we obviously lane Ziggs, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, we saw that really worked to his advantage, able to put down the satchel charges, putting the pressure he needed to. Obviously, Raccoon, the MVP of that game, playing Bard extremely well.
I think this time it's Bobby T.
Oh, definitely Bobby T. This game. I mean, he. He knew where he needed to be, and he knew how to kill everyone who was in his way to be there.
He has that hidden knowledge.
Yeah. He's like, so how will I kill you? Ah, yes, acceleration gate into Q shot.
If this were a movie, it would just cut to, like, a camera pan. Like, he's sitting in his dorm with just, like, a big old, like, dusty tome of, like, how to kill champions. Just learning this hidden knowledge.
Step one, play Jace.
Step one, play Jace. Well, he certainly executed that one quite well. Hats off to you, Bobby T. Lord, look! Still having the highest CS, still having 3 kills and 3 deaths on the losing side. So, the more things change, the more they stay the same, it appears.
I do want to give a shout-out to Lord Luck there, at least, because he did do a very good job of landing some command shockwaves there towards the end of the game.
Sure.
It wasn't when it needed to happen, and the team wasn't strong enough to follow up on him because he was
too late.
He was doing very good. He got Chazzy and actually a couple of late game command shockwaves, and it was what he needed to do. But even with the Pengu there, Necropolistic wasn't able to tank up like he needed to even survive in the back line to be a harasser. And the Pengu, all he had in terms of tank items really were his magic resist boots and the dead man's plate, which is not enough to stand up to the 8-1-9 Cass.
You know,
the 6-2-7 Varus, it just wasn't what you needed to, especially when you have the peel and the heal of Raccoon on Nami.
Sure. We were laying so much praise onto Bobby T, it almost feels remiss to just brush off Yami and Chazzy as outstanding damage dealers throughout this game. Chazzy wasn't necessarily as flashy this game as we saw on the Orianna, but so consistent, and the numbers speak for themselves, 8-1-9, only giving up the one death throughout the game. So.
Right.
All in all, huge GGs and WPs to our teams of the night. George Brown And Queens, we thank you so much for joining us. We will be pulling up the schedule here to show that a little later on tonight we got Simon Fraser versus UC Santa Cruz. Some big names in the scene for collegiate. Simon Fraser being quite renowned as a collegiate team through ULAW. So stick around to check that one out. We will be back tomorrow as well with some Shawnee State versus Nebraska. I believe Stocky, you and I are actually bringing that one to the people loud and proud again. So please tune in for that. We are going to kick it over to some commercials to wind down the stream. Thank you so much for joining us. You could have been anywhere. You chose to be here. It means a lot to us. Have a good night, ladies and gentlemen. Hope to see you back here
only
at 10.
$14.99.
Don't miss the call. Download Band. Communication made easy.
Ben, Sam, and Ken are on separate journeys to defeat the menacing vile dragon. But let's just say luck isn't on their side. If only there was a way for them to find each other and band together. Well, that's why there's Band. It's a mobile app that allows people to come together using common interests. With Band, you can find fellow gamers, chat, schedule gaming sessions, and conduct polls. Stage epic battles with friends while sharing videos and photos along the way. So try Band today. Band. Be together.